Hi, I'm Pastor Carrie, pastor of Chevy United Methodist Church, and I'm glad you're watching today. I'm here to just talk about how excited I am that, you know, COVID is kind of, the restrictions are off and we are back in live worship. This church did not shut down during COVID. We stayed very busy, did a lot of ministry and mission, and maybe you were even part of some of that, but there's more to come. Right now, I'm excited that we're about to launch a brand new website where you can go to the page called Get Connected, and you can see a list of all the ministry and mission that we do and find a way for you to get connected to serving your community. Right now, we're working in partnership with Cheviot Elementary School. Our members here are taking what they know and being part of the summer enrichment program, teaching kids about science and building things and water and music. We are having a great time. This is a church that if you really want to make a difference with your life and connect with the community, we have many, many ways to do that. So we hope you check us out on our website, but more, even better, come and check us out some Sunday morning, 10 o'clock for blended worship. Hope to see you there.
Purple night. Thomas Gilsum lived a long and difficult life because of being very fragile in his health, and also just could not even hold down a job for that long of time because of his health. But he came to Christ at the age of 27, and during that time, the scriptures became very important to him. And one of those favorite scriptures was Lamentations 3, 22, 23. And it reads, "The Lord's loving kindnesses indeed never cease, and his compassion never fails. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness." Isn't it comforting to know that every morning that we get up, that God's faithfulness, his compassion, and his kindness are with us? Let's sing our first hymn, the great hymn, "Great is thy faithfulness," and let's reaffirm our faithfulness in our God.
Good morning. You may be seated. This is a great day. It's a beautiful day out, and the July 4th. What a better day than July 4th. A few announcements. Remember, today, Special kids programs will be offered, and that's today. And then the next one is August 1st, kids 5th grade and below. Online worship will begin. You'll be able to see it on Monday for viewing after Sunday. This is a special one, Celebrate Chevy at School Entertainment Program. It's on Saturday, July 10th from 4 to 6. I wasn't told if anyone wants to make an announcement other than me, but it looks like an awfully fun time. I won't be there, but it looks like a fun time. I'll be with my family, first time in 19 months for one part of the family, so okay. I'm pretty excited about that. When the disciples first started to walk with Christ, they probably imagined a trouble-free, safe, and predictable journey. But as the first followers set out in the book of Acts, they encountered trouble on all sides. Just like their ancestors who tried to rebuild the wall around Jerusalem, the builders of God's kingdom had to learn to stay focused on the task despite opposition and hardship from within and without.
You're welcome to join us in singing, but you can remain seated. We've been standing for a while. But this song is called, Is He Worthy?
Do you feel the world is broken?
You do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new?
We do.
Sing with us.
Is all creation groaning? Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
Is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
It is.
Is anyone worthy?
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he's David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of our blessing? Does the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And is Jesus our Messiah forever those he loves?
He does.
Does our God intend and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, from every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priests to God to reign with. with the Son.
Well, let's go before the Lord together in prayer. Gracious God, your grace is all around us. It's lived out in the people who are here. And we are thankful that each and every morning as we see the sunrise, we can celebrate that your mercies are new every morning. And every night as we lay our head on the pillow, no matter what happened during the day, we can rest in the knowledge that you are faithful and that you will never leave us. Your word says that even in the middle of the night when we wake up and we're troubled about something and we can't get back to sleep, Lord, you are with us even then. So we just sit this morning and we bask in gratefulness for who you are. Lord, at the same time, we know that there are many struggles that are going on in our lives, in the lives of those who are here, prayers that have been mentioned and others that have not been mentioned. You know about them all, and you know about the struggles of those who are around us, who aren't in church this morning, who have no faith, who do not know you and feel as if they are alone. Lord, we so much want to reach them with hope. Lord, we lift up our nation this morning. We ask that as a nation, that we would turn to you, that we would humble ourselves, we would pray to you, and we would really repent of the wrong direction that we are going, that we have gone in the past. In every way, Lord, let this become a nation under God, that you would bless us. For each one of us here today, Lord, you've met us where we are, but we pray that you would not leave us where we are, that you would take hold of our heart, whether it be through the message or the music or just a conversation, and you would continue to grow us into the likeness of your Son Jesus. In every way, we offer ourselves to you in grateful thanks for what you will do. And now we pray together the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. As we prepare for our offering, and if you haven't been here for a while, you will notice that our offering plates are located at the exits of the sanctuary, so we encourage you as you leave to place your offering there. But you know there's more than one way that we offer. We offer certainly our money, which is so important to the ministry, but we also offer ourselves. And so I just want to give a shout out and a cheer, because last week, we talked about this Chevy at School event that's coming up on July 10th. Do you know that we have over 40 people in this congregation who have agreed to give their time and for the benefit of children and the families that we are going to meet? That's amazing. That's like getting up around like 50% But we can go higher. I know we can. I want to thank all of you who offered and did offer your time. And I think there's still time to do that between now and July 10th if you want to come out and be a part of one of the best things we're going to do all year, which is Saturday from 4 to 6. You can offer your time in that way. Thank you for your generosity.
Would you join me in the offering prayer? Gracious God, we thank you for trusting us to reflect your glory, for claiming us as your own with all of creation. As you receive these gifts and offerings, continue to strengthen and guide us in the way of life, that we could build your kingdom through the use of these gifts. Amen. The scripture reading today is Acts 27, 33 to 44. Just before dawn, Paul urged them all to eat. For the last 14 days, he said, you have been in constant suspense and have gone without food. You haven't eaten anything. Now I urge you to take some food. You need it to survive. Not one of you will lose a single hair from his head. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, that scripture that we read this morning is kind of found in the middle of a very exciting, harrowing story. If you have ever read the story that begins in the first verse of chapter 27, if you haven't read it, I recommend going and reading it, because it is full of crises. It is full of Paul and his companions being in dire straits. And it's the story of what God does in the middle of that difficult journey. I wonder, have you ever been in a conversation with a group of people who are always trying to one-up you on how bad something was? You know, like you mentioned about getting stuck in traffic for an hour coming home from work, and before you finish, they're like, oh, that's nothing. You ever heard people go, oh, that's nothing. We got stuck from coming home from vacation for 2.5 days. We were stuck in the car. We had no place to sleep or eat. It's always worse than what you've been through. Or, you know, maybe you talk about having a routine medical procedure, and then they want to tell you about how complicated their procedure was, you know, and how it just didn't turn out the way it should. We just want to one-up each other on how bad things are. I don't know why we want to do that. But when I read this story of what Paul and his companions went through just to do God's mission in the world, I feel a little bit like that. Everyone goes through tough times in life. Many of us right now are going through some tough times. There are unexpected crises that seem to come out of the blue. There are long, protracted challenges like we've just come out of, a pandemic lasting more than a year. Storms that can overtake us, health conditions for our loved ones that don't seem to be getting better. Someone said, you may have heard it, you're either moving into a crisis, you're in the middle of a crisis, or you're on the way out of a crisis, but crises seem to happen in life. Jesus said, in this life, you will have trouble. And the same is true for ministry today. It seems like it's getting harder. Here we are in the midst of this sermon series on building God's kingdom. And when we think about actually going out into the world to do that, drawing people to God, sometimes the challenge seems too much for us. Not only do we face our own personal life issues, but as Christians, God wants us to reach people with the message of the gospel. Talk to people who may not care one bit about God or Jesus or the Bible or anything else that we believe in. This Christian life that we have been called to live, this kingdom-building adventure that we've been given, just feels often overwhelming. Shouldn't life with God be easier? More predictable? But you know, whenever I'm feeling really discouraged, whenever my story seems too hard and I'm wondering where God is in the midst of all of it, I love to pull out Acts chapter 27 and I read it again. And I'm once again one-upped by Paul in his missionary journey. Because the story starts out with him preaching the gospel to non-Jewish people, just as God told him to do. And as a result, there's a plot to kill him. What is that about, God? He is then arrested. He pleads his case before two kings. They accuse him of blasphemy, and they put him on a ship with 276 other prisoners, and after a long and arduous journey, not going where they thought they were supposed to go, a storm comes up like no other storm any of them had ever experienced. They are tossed around, it says, for 14 days. They do not eat a thing. And when the storm doesn't let up and things start looking really bad, the guards who are guarding the prisoners, Paul being one of them, decide that the best thing to do is to kill all the prisoners Because if any of them escape in the storm, well, the guards are going to be killed because they're responsible for them. So Paul, in a fit of leadership that we don't really know where it comes from, except we do, talks them down from that idea. He gets all of the people on the ship and he tells them to have one final meal, throw all the food overboard, turn the sails toward land, and pray. And he promises them, not one single hair on your head will be harmed. But then it gets worse. The ship gets stuck on a sandbar, and the ship begins to break apart. And they start clinging to the boards of the ship for life, while the current takes them into a foreign island with natives they've never met before. Are you getting the idea? It's not going well. This is just one story of Paul's missionary journey. One event that these disciples had to go through just to preach the gospel, just to start one church. And as difficult as life and ministry can get today, I don't even want to try to compete with Paul's story. Do you? Because as hard as it's been, it's not yet been Acts 27 hard. Some days when we become discouraged and tired, we can remind ourselves that we haven't yet had to cling to the broken pieces of a ship and be swept towards shore. And even more than that, in the book of Hebrews, the writer says, "In your struggles, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding blood." It seems that no matter how hard it seems for us right now, there is someone who has had it harder. And they did it because it mattered that much. Now, this is not in any way to minimize the very real struggles that we face today. There are many. But the truth is, somewhere along the way, Christians have gotten the idea that the Christian life, Christian ministry should be trouble-free. And if we don't read stories like the one that we read today, we're in danger of believing that if we are encountering problems or opposition or even life-threatening situation as we follow God with our life, then something must be wrong. We hit hard times and we start to think, well, maybe God has forgotten me. Maybe God has abandoned me. I imagine as Paul was clinging to those broken pieces of ship, floating in a storm-tossed ocean, he might have wondered the same thing. But then I went back and I reread this story. Sometimes when we're reading quickly through Scripture, we can miss very important parts of the story. And I noticed something that I hadn't seen before. When the storm was at its peak, Paul decides to do something crazy. Now, I want you to imagine for a moment that you are back on that ship. It's been storming for 14 days. You haven't eaten anything. The waves are crashing over the side of the boat, and everyone on the boat knows this is not going to end well. Night comes. The storm keeps raging. When the dawn is breaking, Paul comes to each of them and says, "Let's have communion." What? We're going to have communion? Like right now on the ship? He persists. "I urge you, you take some food. You need it to survive." And if you do, not one of you will lose a single hair on their head. And then he takes some bread and he gives thanks to God and he breaks the bread. Does that sound familiar? And he begins to feed it to each of the people who would normally be lost without it. This is unmovable, unquestioning faith. It's the faith of Paul, who knows that God is with them in the storm, in the midst of the waves and the wind, and a future that without God would certainly end in death for them all. Paul celebrates Holy Communion. And in that moment, he does the wisest thing that any person ever caught in a life-altering situation can do. He brings Christ into the crisis. Here's a principle for us this morning. The Christian life is not free of obstacles, but God can free us from any obstacle when we bring Christ into the crisis. What is called for when life seems to be at its most challenging? When the waves are rocking our boat, what do we do as believers in Christ? We do not retreat. We do not give up. We advance in the midst of that storm. We turn our sail, we catch that wind, and we let it take us where it will. We bring Christ into the crisis. And then with full confidence and trust, we let him take us to the next place that he calls us to go. Now, you and I might not be facing winds and waves this morning, but there are obstacles of all kinds that can threaten to take us under. The challenges facing Paul and his shipmates were unlike ours today, but the cure for those problems is the same as it ever was and ever will be for eternity. By the way, they all reached the island of Malta, and not one of them perished. Here are some obstacles, I think, that can get in the way of our life as we move through Christian life. They can get in the way of ministry as we attempt to do what God is calling us to do. These are our sermon notes for today. 5 obstacles to overcome in building the kingdom, in living life for Christ. Number 1, the obstacle of fear. Fear. The scripture said, Paul said to them, for the last 14 days, you have been in constant suspense and have gone without food. How many, you don't have to put your hand up this morning, but how many right now have been in constant suspense about something that is going on in your life? A problem that you can't figure out or face. Bring Christ into the crisis to overcome fear. The second is the obstacle of excess baggage. I love this part. He says, when they had eaten as much as they wanted, they lightened the ship by throwing the grain into the sea. You know, there's nothing like a crisis to help us see what we don't need to carry anymore. Allowing what's happening in our life to free us of unneeded baggage. Of course, my water is down there, so I'm going to walk down and get it. Very sorry. Can you turn me off for a minute, Alan, anybody? Maybe there are habits that we need to get rid of. Maybe there are relationships that have been keeping us stuck. Maybe there are attitudes that are keeping us in a place where God doesn't want us to be. Whatever it is, the crisis can be the time that we remove excess baggage. The third one, the obstacle of immovability. Their ship struck a sandbar, and it says it ran aground, and when it ran aground, when it was immovable, it started to break apart. You know, sometimes when we're in a crisis, we can become so immovable. And sometimes what is necessary is a willingness to allow God to move us, to open our minds to new ways of thinking, new ways of behaving, to let go of our need to control and trust God. That helps us remove the obstacle of immovability. The fourth was the obstacle of doubt. When neither sun nor stars appeared for many days and the storm continued raging, it says they finally gave up hope of being saved. But God had different plans, didn't he? In the midst of our crisis, we can allow doubt to completely overtake us, even though God may have a different plan for our life. And finally, they met and overcame the obstacle of opposition. How many have ever found when you step out and start doing something for God that opposition happens? Things start going wrong. People get in your way. Have you ever noticed that? They faced it. The soldiers on their ship planned to kill them to prevent any of them from escaping. But again, when we bring Christ into the crisis, God can remove the opposition. God can remove our doubt. God can remove our fear. God can remove our sense of control and move us in the direction that he wants us to go. Paul's incredible faith in God allowed him to have three things that are desperately needed when we're in the middle of a crisis. First of all, Paul had a connection to God. How did he know how to tell all these people what to do? Well, it's because he did not wait until the crisis came to hear God's voice and learn to respond to it. He listened and responded. You know, we need to practice that before the crisis hits. We need to connect to God to hear his voice. Second, Paul, because he was connected to God and had a relationship with him, he had confidence in the crisis. It's possible to have confidence in the midst of a crisis when you know that Jesus is in it with you. How many can say amen? How many can say right now, I have confidence in the middle of the crisis that I'm facing? Paul had such confidence in what he was saying that even the soldiers that wanted to kill them followed his orders. And finally, Paul was able to demonstrate calmness when everything around him was in chaos. Calmness in a crisis is what allowed him to help other people navigate the storm, to help other people know what to do, and to have people follow him even when it seemed hopeless. This is what we can expect when we bring Christ into the crisis. No matter the outcome, We know that we're being led in the right direction. You know, there are many people today who are facing crises who don't know that God is with them. They know nothing of this hope that we claim to have. And they're allowing fear right now to paralyze them. This is the call of the church, that those who are connected to God, those who have confidence in God's word, those who can exhibit calmness in the midst of it, we can be a beacon to others and lead them to shore. Who knows what some of the families are facing who will be with us on July 10th. They will come with smiles on their faces and looking as if everything is okay, but deep down, it might not be. They may need the hope. And we can be the Acts 27 Paul to them. One of the best ways to start, and I think we're beyond starting, I think we're down the road a bit in this, but is getting to know the particular life struggles of the people who live in this community, the people whom God is bringing to us, the people sitting in church on Sunday morning. We need to learn about what they're facing. This is where we're headed next week, to learn about the crises in our community and how we can be the calm in their storm. But you know, Paul was just following the model that Jesus had shown the disciples. And he had told the disciples, if you're going to feed others, you need to be fed too. And that's why we do communion here, why we break the bread and we drink the cup, because we are strengthened in our ministry and in our life. And so that's what we're going to do now. on the night in which he gave himself up for us. He took bread, he gave thanks to God, and he broke the bread. And he said, "Take, eat. This is my body, broken for you. Every time you do this, remember me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to God, and he offered it to his friends. And he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Each time you drink, remember me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. And Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. The body of Christ, broken for us. The blood of Christ shed for us. Because there is one loaf, we who are many, we are one body, and we share in the one loaf. The bread in which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Faith and the journey of faith about how when we walk through life, we want to be led by the Spirit as we go along. And one of the lines in the chorus is, "You're the light that leads me. You're the love that keeps me," or "It's your love that keeps me. So be the one who guides me." And I thought, well, that's a little repetitious when you say, "You're the light that leads," and then it says guide. And I got to thinking about the Holy Spirit kind of revealed to me that one thing is just to be led. You know, when you're following somebody on the highway, "Well, I'll follow. You lead, I'll follow," right? But a guide, what does a guide do? A guide shows you stuff along the way when you go on a tour, something. That's what the guide does. So as our journey goes along, we're not just following. We need to allow the Lord to show us stuff along the way. So it's not so much about the destination as it is about the journey. And that's the name of this song. It's called The Journey.
singing with us. So every week we remind ourselves why we exist as a church, who we are as Christians, what we're called to do. This is our vision statement, and we can read it together today. Our vision is to connect and serve all people so that lives are transformed and empowered through the love of Christ. As you go out today, know that you are in the palm of God's hand, and He will be with you always. Until we meet again, see you next time. Jesus.